Hey now, Steve Severs of Bionic Buzz. I'm high tech today. I got my tablet full of questions. I'm here with John.
Yeah. You're very techie.
Yes.
He's very techie, he is.
I'm so excited to talk to you. John, when did you first become a professional musician, and what or who were your musical influences?
Okay, good question. Well, I started off as a child prodigy, really, because my dad was a jazz drummer. Yeah, he was a professional jazz drummer. So by the time I was three, he was teaching me all this stuff, and I heard a lot of it. So he was my main influence in the beginning. So he was teaching me Latin music and jazz things as a little kid, and some drum and bugle corps stuff, cause like rudiments. Okay. So I ended up being in drum corps later on in my teens. But it started with him, and so there was a lot of music around the house, and all kinds of stuff, and I was... As I got older, I started listening to Motown and, of course, Beatle music, Beach Boys, you know, all the songs of the times. I always had my little radio with my little transistor thing there, you know. We had those back before the kids, you know, transistor radio. And a lot of influences.
Yeah. So I got to know, how many musical instruments can you play then? You know, you started on drums, you know. Obviously.
Yeah, drums started. And then when I was about 14, I took a little bit, 6 months of piano lessons. Mm-hmm. You know, so I started piano, and then I picked the guitar up, and found a voice that I could sing, and then I also started playing the bass, and the bass came because I was in a band at 15 years old called Street Machine, and I was the drummer in it, but I was the singing drummer, you know, I was the main singer. It's kind of like, you know, the drummer from the Eagles, and I'm singing there, and I was like, I love playing the drums, I love singing, but I like to be out there.
Yeah.
And I don't really want to play lead guitar. I want to stay in the rhythm section.
Mm-hmm.
So I figured, well, it's got two less strings, so I'll just play bass. And of course, the Paul McCartney and Beatle influence.
Yeah.
I went and did that.
And where and when did you perform first on stage? Like, you mentioned that your first band. What age was that? You
know? That was, I was 15 or 16. Okay. But the first time I was ever on stage was at my Upper Nyack school. My town is Nyack, New York, up in upstate New York. And it was, it's just, I'll tell you the year or so, I'm not give away my age, but I'm going to do it anyway. It doesn't matter. 1968, okay? I was like six or seven, and I went, and they had a talent show, and so I didn't know how to play anything, but I had to, you know, I had the courage to sing a bit. Mm-hmm. So they had a little, one of those little 45, you know, school players that they have.
Oh, yeah.
And I brought in I Should Have Known Better from the Beatles. Put it on there, and I knew all the words, of course. And I stood there, and the mic was actually live. I didn't mime. There was no lip-syncing. It actually sang live. Don't remember how good it was. All I know is all the little kids went like this. And I said,
wow.
That felt good, you know?
So your passion for that started right there.
Yeah, but then I saw the Beatles on the Ed Sullivan Show 4 years earlier. Mm-hmm. So my dad said, hey, you can stay up past your bedtime. I just turned five. They played live. Everybody knows February 9th, 64, and live for, you know, and we were in New York. We saw it. I saw that thing, and I was like, wow. Forget Topo Gigio. I mean, I'm all about this. A girl screaming and those guys singing, woo-woo. I said, yeah, that's great.
So you start singing the Beatles when you're young. What age did you start composing, actually, your own original music?
I started writing around 15 when I started playing guitar and piano. Yeah. I started doing, you just got that inspiration from all this great music. I said, well, they can do it, I can do it. You know, let me try it. You know? So some of the few first songs I don't think were very good, as most of us that start out, but you need to develop it. It's a craft, you develop it. So,
well, this next question I'm very excited about, because you've actually worked at Abbey Road Studios, and you've actually got to meet Sir Paul McCartney. Tell us every little detail about that. That's got to be so amazing.
Yeah, it was amazing. I met him, I met Paul McCartney and George Martin, the Beatles producer, the same afternoon.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, and they were working on, the backstory is they were working on the Beatles anthology.
Okay.
And which came out on national television, well, worldwide.
Yeah, it was the unreleased John Lennon song.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, Free as a Bird, yeah. So they were working on that stuff. November of 95 is when it came out, but I was there on July 20th of 95, and that's when I met him and George Martin. And it was just amazing. He was in the, I was sitting at this little bar in the artist lounge, the restaurant just for the Abbey Road staff and the artists. I was sitting there and having a Guinness with this fellow I knew, because I'd been there since 85. I did a lot of sessions there. So this was like my sixth or seventh session I did there. And I'm sitting at the bar, and so I saw George Martin come in, and he got a plate of food down there. And then I kind of watched him as he, you know, I'm sitting at the bar and watched him walk over. And then I saw McCartney sit next to him and his assistant, John Hammond. So there, the three of them sitting there. Now, there was George Martin with his back to me, but McCartney sat down and was looking straight at me. You know, it was like 10 feet away, maybe. So I just sat there and said, oh, wow, I've always wanted to meet the Beatle. This guy is, you know, wow, this is the one, right?
Yeah.
This is the time. But the problem was, is that, you know, being an artist, I knew all the staff there, you know, was friends with a lot of them. And from a professional point of view, I was not going to bother the man.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
I was there as as an artist like he was. So it's fine if you meet somebody like that, on the way into the studio or on the street, but I didn't want to do that. But I was like, oh, I got to meet him, though. It would really be nice. So what ended up happening was we did get kind of introduced because he was there. He was looking at me anyway. He could check. He was checking me out, looking at us. He'd be eating. I'm going, man, he's got my number, you know. And it was cool. And he came over, and we shook hands. And he said, I said, hey, Paul, I'm John. And he says, hey, John, are you working here? That's the first thing he wanted to know.
Oh,
you working here? I said, yeah. I said, I am. I said, I got a session coming up next week. He goes, checking the place out, eh? I said, well, no, actually, I've been here before. I said, I've recorded here over the last 10 years. I did an album called Matthew Street. And he said, Matthew Street, that sounds familiar. And then it was great. And then he said, oh, good luck in your recording, man. And I said, thanks a lot. You know, it was just a minute. Shook hands. Off he went.
Still, that's amazing.
Oh, it was great. Yeah. And it was so weird, like, to meet him. You know, it's like, because, you know, that was an album cover to me. You know, it was Meet the Beatles and the guy. And I remember he was standing there, and I, you know, and he was talking to me, and then he kind of turned away for a second. Somebody said something, and then and I kind of looked down. He had sandals on. I said, "That's those famous feet that walk across Abbey Road." It was just surreal, you know. But he was really gracious and very cool. Yeah.
Well, when did you start doing your own Paul tribute show? I guess you know.
I was always playing the music, you know, with bands and stuff in the 70s and 80s growing up, of course, you know, the variety bands. I'd always do I Saw Her Standing There or Lucille or something, you know. But I actually started doing it where I would, you know, kind of dress like it and do a Beatle in 90 when I came down from New York. Okay. And it was a little duo called the Beat Boys with a friend of mine named John Link, really good singer and a Beatle lover like me. So we put this little duo together, and it was we were way ahead of our time because we were using tracks that we made up in the studio and had a kind of little story that would go. And we'd do two sets. It'd start off, and we would play the songs chronologically from, like, Love Me Do to, you know,
cool.
Come Together and
yeah.
All that. Yeah, so that was the beginning of it, and then we did that for a couple of years. Then I started playing solo some more and doing some of his McCartney stuff and Beatles stuff. Then I got the gig at Epcot. I auditioned for the British Invasion. Disney's okay. Yeah.
I'm a huge Disney fan. That's quite an honor.
Yeah, oh, it was great. Yeah, 1997, and I did 17,000 shows there.
Wow.
17,000 shows in 11 years. Mm-hmm. So it was five shows a day, 6 days a week. Not 8 days a week.
But six days. Good one.
But you know, what was really cool about it was that those guys, Jimmy Pappas, Leo Rojo, and Sean Bryant, all very good friends of mine, we still work together, and three of them play in the band when I do the McCartney show. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Paul is all. Tribute.com.
I was going to say, you read my mind. I was going to ask the website, because, you know, you mentioned shows. I hopefully shows are coming back as things are going to get to normal. So website, where can people can find out about new shows?
Yeah, yeah. PaulIsAllTribute.com. So, yeah, it's really cool. And what happened was, because of all the things I did as Beatle Paul, actually, when I first got the gig, they signed me up to do John Lennon.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because it wasn't really a full-blown Beatles show at that point. It was like 60% Beatles songs, and the rest was Jerry the Pacemakers and Hermes, the Stones, The Who. So it was a little bit more generic.
Yeah.
And then what happened was the guy that was doing the McCartney spot left in 2000, and then I ended up taking it over, which was fine with me, because I'd done it before anyway. And they said, well, you look more like Paul than John, and certainly look more like Paul than Ringo. So it was all right, you know, it was good. So I made the transition, went over there and did it, and that was it.
Such a fascinating story talking to you. Let's end with another song of yours, all right?
Oh, absolutely. Why not?
I see.